I am here to share with you my experiences with Rigveda, which is known to be a religious text, very highly revered by the Hindus. But when I tried to read it, I found that it was very abstract, that I couldn't make anything out of it. Then I just wondered why it should be so that a book which is so highly revered and supposed to be very important, so why it should be so abstract. So I must find out some reasons for it. And when I just tried to decode the whole thing and try to understand it, so I found that there are various reasons for that. So most people think that the reason may be related to language, because it is written in Sanskrit and the style of Sanskrit there is somewhat different than the style of Sanskrit which is present nowadays. So therefore, basically it is not a question of a language, so there must be some other problem related to it. Now actually, I found that the things are so difficult and so abstract that one can only compare it with the Egyptian pyramids or the airfields at high hilltops in South America. So, to decipher or to decode such a very abstract text was a very challenging task. But my interest did take me to solve this riddle once for and all. I found that various people have made various efforts for the last 5,000 years or so to draw some meanings or draw some conclusions from it. But all these interpretations, they fall into two main categories. One, completely devoid of science, and some philosophical content or some spiritual discipline aspect of it. Then, for the last couple of centuries, there were some efforts made by Western scholars, and they sensed that there is some science in it. So when I wrote some of those books, I was highly surprised that how a religious text could contain scientific content. So whether it is really true or not. And because my particular background was that of a scientist, I just hit upon the effort. I say hit upon, that is because it was a very big challenge. So but I just took the challenge on myself and making use of my knowledge of Sanskrit and knowledge of science, I just tried to find out if I can do something about it. Absolutely, I had no hopes in the beginning that I could do something. I will show you the very first verse in the Rigveda. So literally it means, so I praise the fire. So Agni is fire. So I praise the fire that carries the job. Now what job this Agni is supposed to carry? Of the main priest. So there is a yajna ritual. It is referring to some yajna ritual. So Agni is carrying the job of the main priest in that yajna ritual, as well as one of the priests who recites the mantras. So there are 7 or 8 people who recite the mantras. So they are called Rutvija. Then Purohit is a person who just manages the whole ritual. So that is about the yajna ritual. Then this fire is also the main deity of the yajna. So every ritual has got some deity about it. And this same Agni is the main deity also. So the same Agni, he does these various things, and he is also the deity of the yajnas. And he is also the organizer of the yajna, and the most funny thing is, you may call it funny, or very abstract, or irrelevant, or incongruent. So it is brightly luminous jewel. So how can Agni, which is a fire, so he can recite the mantras, first of all, then carry out so many duties of various kinds in the yajna ritual, and finally, it is like a yajna ritual. So it is all completely incongruent, if we can very clearly see. And this is just the very first mantra in the Rig Veda, which gives no background, no reference, no explanation. So you have to work out for yourself the meaning of the various things, and which you can very clearly see that it is very difficult to correlate a jewel-like behavior of a particular entity, and that entity is a fire, and that entity is also a deity, that entity is also doing so many jobs for the yajna ritual. So that means there must be something. Either many people, when they read this, the things like that, they said that these are the verses written by some madmen, because it is just like an incongruent talk. They don't know what they are talking about. So that was the general impression. But I was not believing in this. I sternly believed that when such a revered book is revered to such a high level by the Hindus, and all the subsequent literature is supposed to be based upon that, then it cannot be a work of a madman at all. So therefore, there must be some meaning, and it must be something like a code. So you have to find out some suitable code so that you can understand it congruently. So that is one thing. Then Rig Veda is a very big volume. So this is one verse. Rig Veda contains more than 10,000 verses like this. So the difficulty is not only with one verse, but the same difficulty will persist with all more than 10,000 verses. And every verse is independent of the other verse. So you cannot say that I understood one verse so that I will understand the second verse. So each verse has to be understood independently. And that is not enough. Because if you have to understand something, in all these 10,000 mantras or verses, the same sense should be prevalent. So there must be a consistency in the meaning. So you can see that you have decoded the whole thing. If there is a consistency in all the verses that are available in the Rig Veda. So that is naturally you can understand the difficulty presented and the difficulty in solving this. Here perhaps the Rig Veda is referring to Agni as electromagnetic energy. Now let us start with this. So if Agni is an electromagnetic energy, now if we know fire, from the scientific consent of fire is electromagnetic energy. So it fits the description of fire into electromagnetic energy. Those who have studied science, they will agree with me that fire is nothing but a electromagnetic energy. Then we must understand what is this yajna. So this Rig Veda is constantly referring to yajnas, various types of yajna, the various deities in the interest of the universe. So the various entities are actually the physical entities, and they carry out various reactions and various jobs in the evolution of the universe. So basically, most of the content of the Rig Veda is about the evolution of the universe or cosmology. So if one has some background of cosmology, then there is a better chance of understanding the Rig Veda and the meaning of the various entities. So those who have got some background of science, so they know that if this electromagnetic energy is in the form of a laser beam, so laser beam has got two important characteristics. One, it is very bright than ordinary light. And secondly, it is of a very pure color because of a particular frequency. So naturally, one can easily understand why it is called a very bright jewel. So therefore, our understanding of this Agni as electromagnetology, that completely fits it into this description. And we get a very clear meaning of this particular physical process, that the electromagnetic energy is doing this much of work, of these types of work in that physical process. Like that, so many physical processes are described and in which different types of entities are involved. Now we are satisfied with Agni as electromagnetic energy. Then what should be our next move? Our next move is to use this knowledge, because in another verse, there will be a correlation between Agni and some other term. For example, Vayu. So normally, Vayu we understand as wind. But actually, the meaning of Vayu in Rig Veda is not this wind. Because what Rig Veda is doing, it is telling us the whole cosmology from the beginning of the universe. And in the early stages of the universe, so electromagnetic energy could be converted into unstable or transient, as we call, a physical state, which we call Vayu. So it is this unstable physical state which Rig Veda is referring to when it is called Vayu. So naturally, the description of Vayu should not be the description of ordinary wind, but it should be the description of electromagnetic energy which is in that particular state of instability. And therefore, Vayu is different from a normal electromagnetic energy. So with this understanding of Vayu, so one can now correlate this Agni with Vayu. Then we are satisfied with two terms. Like this, we go on extending. So the important terms that are used, so they are like Vayu, so they are like Marut. So again, our present understanding, that is general understanding, is Marut is something like a flow of wind. So here again we are deceived, because in terms of these physical processes as described in cosmology, so this Marut is not a flow of wind, but it is an entity which is responsible for doing many activities. For example, I was so highly surprised that when I read the description of Marut, so the description of Marut was in the form of a tensor. So if one has got a mathematical background, then one clearly sees what is a tensor. So the description of our present understanding of the tensor completely fits the description of Marut in the Rig Veda. For example, in our tensor, so it is like an assembly of certain components, and there are certain rows and certain columns. So like that, so if it is a particular entity is in the tensor form, then there can be, say, 7 components for one row, then 14 components for two rows, then 21 components for third row, like that. So when I read the description of Marut in the Rig Veda, I completely found that Marut has got 7 components, 14 components, 21 components, up to 63 components. So that means a tensor with a 7 quantities in one row and 9 columns like this. So they will have 63 quantities. Now these 63 quantities can be decomposed into less number of rows. Now when I was thinking about this, I got the answer in the Rig Veda itself. Rig Veda says that all this science has to be used for spiritual discipline. So they established a clear link between science and spiritual discipline. So they established direct correlation between the various stages of the evolution of the universe and the evolution that occurs in mind following a particular spiritual discipline. Nowhere I had found such a direct correlation between science and the spiritual discipline so clearly stated. Because the general idea is that, or the general perception is that the two are very different fields. Or many people even think that they are opposing fields. So here we find that they are not only opposing fields, but they are very consistent fields, and one is meant for the others. And Rig Veda covers both, and stating all those things very clearly, and they also explain how this can be done. Now see, this is the idea that universe is talking all about, that universe is expanding. We came to know about this expansion of the universe only in the last century, when we tried to develop cosmology. Then there was a definition of space. So we go all the credit to Einstein for this understanding of gravitation in terms of space. So therefore, this idea of cosmology in terms of the expansion of the universe and the definitions of the space and the various particles, antiparticles that are present in the universe. So what correlation they have got with the spiritual discipline? The basic concept developed by Rig Veda is like this. That is, as the universe is expanding, so that now we also agree, as the universe is expanding, so we find that the agitation in the universe is also increasing. Now man is also a part of nature. So man also must be subject to this. That is, we are not the same from the beginning to the end. So as the universe is changing, man is also changing. Therefore, the spiritual discipline involves the taking of the mind to a condition of less and less agitation. So the basic concept of spirituality is taking the mind to more and more higher levels of concentration. Because concentration decreases the agitation. And when the agitation is decreased to such a low level that our spirituality is increased to such a high level that we find everywhere compassion, friendship, and the ultimate of friendship is the whole universe is your friend. That's why in the beginning I addressed you as friends. That is the ultimate of the spiritual discipline. The various details of the scientific knowledge that are available now, as after decoding the Rig Veda, right from the expansion of the universe, there are many ideas like this. So one important idea is about the change of space. Because in our present concept, we feel that the space has been the same throughout, right from the beginning. But Rig Veda says it is not so. So there are distinct steps in the expansion of the universe. And after a certain stage is reached, there is a sudden change in the space or nature of the universe. So this is called a phase transition in terms of science. Now actually, presently, we are not thinking about such change in the phase transition in spaces. As we try to increase our compassion, as we try to increase our concentration levels, so we have to do it gradually, because the changes in the universe is expanding slowly. Similarly, the changes in mind or brain will come about slowly. Then we will come to a certain stage when the concentration levels have increased, our sense of friendship and compassion have increased, then there will be a sudden jump. You will find that in your personality, in your mind and brain, so there is a sudden jump, so that you have got a much increased compassion, levels of compassion and camaraderie and friendship. So like this, if you go on continuing it, so we will find that ultimately you will have the ultimate feeling of the universe being your complete friend. So this knowledge of spirituality and science and the various aspects of spirituality, so various aspects of knowledge of science. So there are so many things, which many discoveries which we have discovered only a last century or a couple of centuries. So these are from this both points of view, that is the information on science and the link between the spirituality and science, from both these points of view, so this work is extremely important to my mind. So particularly those who are interested in science, so they can find that, they can make use of this knowledge, which has got their own system of science, and therefore they can enhance our present understanding of science. But all this requires an open mind, because presently we are bogged down by a particular theory, which is a Big Bang theory, and try to use quantum mechanics everywhere in that theory. Now, Rigveda has got different ideas and different system of science. So if we have got an open mind, if we have got a spirituality, then we will be inclined to look at these developments and detailed knowledge of science in the Rigveda. And an open mind is a characteristic of, again, a spirituality. Because a person who has got no open mind, so he is just interested in looking in a particular direction. Because he is highly prejudiced. He has got an axe to grind. And all these things, they come in the way of spirituality, in the way of knowledge, and in the way of everything that you want to do. Because all these scientists, great scientists, they have been great spiritually enhanced souls. We remember of Faraday, who worked for 22 days at a stretch for the electromagnetic induction, without even eating, without having even breakfast. So, yeah, which shows a complete link between science and spirituality. So therefore, let us have an open mind. Let our scientists have an open mind, so that we can have a look at this great store of science also. And also spirituality, how it is connected, that is another aspect. So thank you very much.